Well, isn't it truly a delight to see the giftedness of God's people being exalted today and God being lifted up through the sharing of their beautiful gifts, their talents, their music, and their ability to put it together a program like this. Thank you, boys and girls. God is good. God is truly a blessing, a blessing. And sometimes those many blessings of God come wonderfully disguised, if you like. And spring is one of those times when the true blessings of God are disguised in such a beautiful way, such a powerful way. You know, I've had the joy of experiencing what I think a real spring is like. I want to say that to you folks who claim Australia at home, particularly in the northern region, don't really get the taste of spring. And I don't think anybody's ever had the taste of spring until you've grown up on a dairy farm in the heart of New Zealand, and where for 35 days in a row we've had to scrape the ice off the water trough for the cows to drink. And to see the paddocks just white, and you begging for the sun to come up so that the frost won't kill the grass, so that your 100-plus cows will survive. And every day you're wanting winter to end. You know, every winter's day, I would have to make my way to the hay barn. And in that hay barn was all the hay, but there was a Farmer B tractor. I want to tell you, it hated winter. The number of days that I would have to take that distributor cap off. Who knows what a distributor cap is? There's not many people. But we'd have to take that distributor cap off because it didn't like the condensation from the cold winter's day. And I'd have to get a handful of hay and I'd light this hay and I'd try and dry out the distributor cap and get it back on the tractor. But so often I ended up having to crank the old beast. It wasn't easy at 12 years of age. But yeah, winter was a drag. Winter was a bore. But then all of a sudden, whoa, things changed just like that. All of a sudden, you're not worrying about grass not growing. You're worrying about having too much and having to turn it into silage and silage bales and all sorts of things. All of a sudden, instead of having 100 cows to look after, you've got 200 because they all had calves. And so instead of now only working a few hours in a cold, miserable day, you're now up to working 15, 20 hours a day to take care of the new animals and to take care of the milking, because all of a sudden you've got that much grass and the cows are overflowing the vat. And yeah, spring was so beautiful on a dairy farm. It really made a difference. Made a difference in the garden too. Nothing wants to grow in New Zealand in the middle of winter. But when that spring comes around, it's just truly a delight and a joy, and you get that blessing. You know, spring for me is a blessing and a curse. Put up your hands if you get sinus. If you get hay fever. Last Sabbath, I had the beautiful honour of baptising my almost 13-year-old granddaughter down at Yarra Hapney. But we got in the car, we left here, and within half an hour, I'm all of a sudden driving through the sugar cane and I'm driving into the forest, and all of a sudden, sinus explodes. Yeah, spring's supposed to be a blessing. But for many, it's a curse. It's a curse because of that new life causes stuff to happen, and all of a sudden the body can't take it, and so we have to deal with issues, We deal with challenges even in spring. But you know, I've lived in a country where there's no such thing as spring. Anyone lived in a country where there are really no seasons, or there might be a wet season and a dry season, but there's no winter and there's no spring? I know there's a few people here that have been into the Solomons and Papua New Guinea, and there is no spring. It's the same every day, all day. The sun gets up at 6:30, it sits at 6:30, it's 31 degrees in the daytime, it's 29 degrees at nighttime, and if you get lucky, it might get 3 degrees cooler sometimes during the year. And all the time we were living in the Solomons, the one thing I craved more than anything else was winter. Was winter. I just wanted to be cold. I just wanted to have a different atmosphere, a different environment. It was boring with everything being the same repetitious day in, day out. No winter, no summer, no spring. So some people, friends, don't get to experience the true joy of what springtime brings. And of what springtime is. You know, we live, for those of us in a country that have spring, in the expectation of spring coming around. By the way, Tony, I'd just like to say I'd like your new gear today. I just like your new gear, mate. I'll tell you after how I know. Tony, yeah. But yeah, no, for those who, he knows what I'm talking about. Okay, for those of us who don't or who live in an environment where there is no spring, we certainly don't get the idea of what it is that God has planned for us, of what it is that God desires for us to have. And ever since, and even before the flood, the thought of something new coming was always in the minds of all of God's people. Adam and Eve, when the environment of earth changed, the question was, how long? How long will it be before this changes? How long will it be before this gets better and life gets better? And when Noah came along, once that rain started to fall, he no doubt was thinking, how long, Lord? How long is this going to last for? How long will we put up with this situation before things get better? In 377 days, Noah waited and waited, and he looked out that ark, and what did he see? He didn't see this. He didn't see this. He saw this. He saw a barren, dry, empty planet. For life had been taken away from it. But miraculously, it became a thing of great beauty once again. And for 4,000 years since the time of Noah to now, we have been living in the expectations of life for everyone becoming like spring, becoming that moment where everything blossoms, where life is good and life is abundant, rich and full, and we cherish that moment. When we come to the book of Peter, to 2 Peter, the epistle of 2 Peter, he expresses that thought, and he says in 2 Peter 3, verse 13, he says, Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heavens and a new earth in which dwells righteousness. That thought, nevertheless, is a powerful thought. Powerful thought. Life goes on. Regardless, life goes on. And fortunately, we live in an environment where the life cycle is not constant and boring. There is that hint of seasons. Summer gets a bit carried away at times. Winter's not too bad. Autumn, okay. Spring, okay. But even though we are living in a world where things seem to be okay, nevertheless, we still look for something better. You know, I've been to a country where the people call it God's own. Okay, I've lived in a place where people call their country heaven. I've been to a place where they even have the cheek to call it the new earth. And people have that thinking that where they are is the best that God has to offer. And we in our thinking think that spring is the best that God has to offer because it's the semblance of new life. And so Peter, some 30 years after Jesus died on the cross of Calvary, he said, "Nevertheless, we, according to the promise of the one who died on the cross, look for a new heavens and a new earth which dwelleth righteousness." Some 30 years later, another man comes onto the scene. He's been ostracized from society. The joy of life has been taken away from this aging man. And he's exiled to a barren outcrop, to a barren island called Patmos. It was not Hamilton Island, but it had a few beautiful spots among it. But it was an isolated place, some 37 kilometers off the coast of Turkey. And there he was making the best of life, living in a cave, living in isolation, no family, no friends. And God had given this man many pictures, many visions. Some of them weren't very nice. Some of them were of the catastrophes and the chaos that was going to come upon the world prior to the coming of Christ. But then as God takes him through this amazing journey, and when we come to Revelation chapter 21, the most beautiful picture of all is given to John in this isolated place. And not like Peter. Peter says, "Nevertheless, we look for. Nevertheless, we hope for." But John, look what John says in Revelation 21. As God gives him the picture, he says, "Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no more sea." Here is John in this isolated place, given this beautiful picture by God of the new heaven, of the new earth, of all things new. Yes, Peter dreamt of it. John saw it. And that's what kept him motivated. That's what kept him focused. That's what kept him going. Because he had seen a picture from God of that which God desires us all to have, a new heaven, a new earth. The day is coming, friends, when the taste of spring, the taste of joy that is supposed to come to spring, will turn into a moment of exhilaration, exaltation. I don't think there's a word that we'll be able to describe that moment when we step into the season of God's newness. Spring is a moment of new beginnings. Bulbs that have lied dormant in the earth jump out and bring life. I don't know who's been on a tiki tour throughout New Zealand as spring comes about, but as you do, well, this paddock's got daffodils in and that paddock's got daffodils in. All of these farmers have got daffodils growing out of their paddocks, and everybody can tell, wow, spring is here. Spring is here. If you want to see what daffodils really look like, and here's a plug for New Zealand, you need to go to a place called Geraldine. And there's a man at Geraldine, there's a guy at Geraldine who prides himself in daffodils. And he's got, I don't know, 800 or something varieties of daffodils. You all think there's just one, don't you? But they are just absolutely majestic. And when we had the occasion to be there, every one of those varieties was in flower. And as I went around them and all that, I used to grow vireas. And I used to love these vireas, and I used to get the rare ones and try and grow these vireas that had flowers about so big. And it was beautiful. But as we wandered through this daffodil patch, if you like, I saw this one daffodil and I thought, I've got to have that daffodil. And when we got back to the shop, I said, I want to buy that daffodil. And the man said, well, have you got $800? It was $800 a bulb. That's how rare it was. But absolutely, just absolutely amazing to be just there in amongst those daffodils. And I'll tell you, I got a very different appreciation for spring when I was there that time, and just saw, appreciated the variety that God puts into one daffodil. It's just amazing, isn't it? Roses and all of that, the way in which God puts variety before us. Life is not boring. Life is not dull in the presence of God. But I just want you today to get this picture, this vision that John had, that John the Revelator had. Peter dreamed, nevertheless, according to the promises I look for, I desire, I want, I seek. But Jesus gave John a picture of the reality. I want you today, friends, more than anything else, to capture that picture of reality. It's not just a carrot that God dangles there to tempt us towards Him. No, it's more than that. It's reality. It's the real thing. It's the real deal. It's the real deal. The difference between then, Noah's time, and our time is that when Noah came out of that ark, nothing really changed. Nothing really changed. God had intervened in civilization and taken away the evil element that was causing chaos, but nothing changed. Shortly after, the life cycle continues. But I want to say to you today, when we see the heaven, the new heaven and the new earth that John saw in Revelation, everything's changed. For there will be no sin. There will be no sinus. How good will that be? There will be none of those. Even though spring is good, it's still not perfect. But the new earth, the new heaven and the new earth is perfect because God has taken away all unrighteousness and given to us a home of righteousness. He promised in the book of Isaiah that He would create a new heaven and a new earth. I just would like to encourage you today to be there to experience the joy that that is. God bless you. I just want to again give you an invitation to lunch. I know that there's been a very faithful team down there putting together the food that you have brought. And please, please feel free to join us for lunch today. After that, we're then just going to have a little dedication service for the extension of the hall and ask God's blessing upon its ministry. So thank you. Thank you for your worship and fellowship today. Let us pray. Oh, loving Father, I just thank you that this world still yields that from which we can put together such a program as this, that we can exhibit some of the beauty of your creation. Thank you for the gifted hands of Tim who crafted the ark. And we thank you for the beautiful lesson that it teaches us that yes, although this world is going to be challenged and is going to be controlled in a way that you do not like, yet from that chaos, you can make things new. And we look forward to that day when we will pass from the cycle of life on this earth, with spring being the best that it has to offer, to be with you in eternity when we will see of your beauty and grandeur forever. What a joy that will be. What a delight that will be to our soul. Thank you for all who have participated in the program today. Thank you all who put this beautiful presentation together. Thank you, Father, for those who have supplied food and for its preparation and its putting together and serving as a meal. May we, dear Lord, bless us and may it honour you as we continue to share throughout this day. We truly delight in your goodness. And like John, we want to thank you for the glimpse you have given us of that time when it will not just be something that is of a temporary nature, but it is of a permanent nature, and we will start to dwell in that new heavens and that new earth where only righteousness will be our friend. What a joy that will be, and we seek that in and through the name of Jesus. Amen.